Ladies and gentlemen, in the interest of time, I think we should be starting. I hope you had a good lunch, and it's my sincere pleasure to chair this session, which is the first of three that we co-organized together with the Collaborative Research Center on Polymeric Materials for Immunotherapy that is running in Mainz. It's a so-called Sonderforschungsbereich, which is being headed by, as a spokesperson, Professor Rudolf Zentel, who will also give the first talk and who will tell you a little bit more about the Sonderforschungsbereich as such, and also about how we can use nanomaterials for things beyond tumor targeting, for immunomodulation, and so on. Rudolf, please. So
thank you very much for the kind introduction. Obviously, it's great. And I would like to thank the organizer for making it possible that we have here a session. And this session first will be about polymeric materials for cancer therapy. But while we are so broad, we want to focus a bit more on the topic of is there more than tumor targeting nanoparticles and the immune system, which I want to introduce to you. And I think I will make my talk in three sub, will divide it into three subtopics. One would be to address this aspect of the tumor system, of the immune system. In second part, I will talk about some systems we use to address different diseases, also to knock down cells with silencing RNA. And in the last point, I want to come to some complex carbohydrates for targeting purposes. So at first, most of the work with nanomedicine has been done concerning tumor targeting. And this is good. But as we all know, the EPR effect depends strongly on the type of cancer. So it may be good for you or poor. The tumor stroma might be an issue, and finally, it will be necessary to reach all individual tumor cells. In this context, of course, it makes sense to look for alternatives, and then if you look at it, it's just important just to write down for you what you what potential nanoparticles have. And this is, they will naturally accumulate in tissue with a leaky vasculature, like the liver, the spleen, places of inflammation. And the second part for spleen, spleen is the central organ of the immune system, so it makes sense to think of the immune system. And they have the potential to co-deliver several things. Now, considering this, we live in Mainz in our Sonderforschungsbereich with this idea that we somehow believe that the immune system in all its complexity may be especially sensitive to nano-sized objects, just because it is used to handle nano-sized objects like pathogens, fragments of cells. And on the other hand, such a nanoparticle has the potential to co-deliver multiple signals simultaneously, for example, an antigen and a co-stimulus. This is just what is optimal to address the immune system. You can address suitable target cells, which you can easily access in the spleen by having antibodies or other targeting units. And finally, you can transport even sensitive therapeutic agents like DNA or RNA, for which you need nearly a nanoparticle, because you have to shield them from nucleases in the bloodstream. Now, thinking of this, we came up in Mainz with this idea that, in fact, what we say, if you think of an immunotumor therapy and you do not forget the tumor, there may be two things important. One is you need an activation against the tumor. And I think this morning, also in the presentation of Professor Hoffmann, there was already this discussion, how immunogenic is a tumor? And we work with a melanoma. The melanoma is immunogenic. Right? But I think, anyhow, tumor is own tissue. It's not a foreign pathogen. So it is not so easy to stimulate the immune system. So you must think of something very attractive, it's very active. And you have to think of what happens in the lymph nodes around the tumor. On the other hand, all successful and expanding tumors have a tumor-suppressive milieu. And so considering the elimination of immunotolerance is also a very big topic. And you can discuss this on a local issue, which would be maybe targeting the tumor, accumulating in neighboring lymph nodes. And you can think of a systemic application like good circulation to accumulate efficiently in the spleen and to address it as a very central part of the body. And in addition, we have a lot of activities concerning ribonucleic acid because we think it's attractive to either break immune tolerance and to activate the immune system. Now, to chemistry. What do you need? You need carriers for this, and especially for short RNA. We think it's good to have preformed nanoparticles which can circulate it. And so we established a way to make such nanoparticles for siRNA delivering by making blocker polymers, self-assembling them, transforming them into the interior, and loading them with short RNA fragments. This is done based on copolymers. One part is hydrophilic, you see short ethylene oxide chains. The other is contains all fluorinated reactive esters. And so these fluorinated, highly fluorinated compounds have very special solubility problems, properties. And so these block copolymers, they self-assemble in polar aprotic solvents like DMSO. So this is micelle formation in non-aqueous solutions. And we get here micelles. We can determine a CMC in DMSO. We can see that the particle, which is very small, the polymer, which is very small, these are the individual polymer chains in THF, becomes a large micelle in DMSO. And then this compound, where this carrier, which is very hydrophobic in the interior, can be cross-linked. It can be cross-linked by using spermine. This reacts with two amino groups to cross-link it. At the same point, creates two positive charges at the secondary amines as for complexing of oligonucleotides. And this compound then can be efficiently loaded by short RNA fragments, like shown here by fluorescence correlation spectroscopy. And this is the individual siRNA. This is the carrier. And this is the loaded carrier. So this goes, we go willingly into the particle. Now, what can you do with such materials concerning translation? We look for it intensively in mice concerning a model for liver fibrosis. Now, liver fibrosis is not a tumor, but it's a serious disease, which is not so easy to treat. And so we get mice, we treat them so that they get liver fibrosis. And the most important part of this liver fibrosis is that there are activated myofibroblasts, which are special cells in the liver, and they get activated and they produce a huge amount of collagen. And the collagen, then later on, is the problem of the disease because it closes the vessels which go into the liver. And so the idea is if you have an anti-fibrotic siRNA therapy by which you knock down the production of collagen. Now, this siRNA can be loaded into our particles. And so we did investigations with them. What we found is we have here labeled the particle and the siRNA. We see that they both concentrate in the liver, accumulate, they co-localize nicely, both in the liver. And we do not only localize in the liver, we just localize in this alpha SMAR cells, these activated myofibroblasts, which are responsible for the collagen production. And then we could in vivo determine the knockdown of the messenger RNA for collagen and the reduction in protein production, of collagen production, by the knockdown induced by the siRNA, which we deliver systemically in these particles. You see this here as some pictures, where this is a mouse which has not been treated, and you see here massive collagen production around the blood vessels, and here this looks quite normal in comparison. Now, just you can improve the system by making the whole nanoparticle degradable again, caused by increase of pH. You can do this by using cation-based crosslinkers. And this way, you can reduce the knockdown, but you can also come to a situation where you can get multiple dosing. This is, you give a dose, you wait, everything degrades, you give a second dose, and you always come up to the same point, whereas if you do not have biodegradable compounds, you see that you increase the compound, the system, you have amount of polymer in the liver. Now, this idea of having these nanogels can be transformed to other systems. And so I think you will hear something in the presentation of Bruno de Geest later. And I think here they use systems, they loaded them with toll-like receptors. And the special thing is, if you give them close to a tumor, these loaded nanogels, they stay in the vicinity of the tumor, and they get accumulate in the tumor-draining lymph nodes and increase their strong inflammation. And whereas if you give them on a low molar mass compound, they are systemically distributed on the mouse over the whole body, and this is not what you want for treatment. Okay, then I just skip the next one. And then I say another thing, which I maybe can only briefly say, is it just shows you how much chemistry has improved. There are many complex carbohydrates which are selective binders for selectins, like the sialylose X. And they bind to epithelial cells. If there's an inflammation, they bind to macrophages and to everything. And it's now possible to synthesize this tetrasugar and to link it to a polymer chain. And by presenting it in a multivalent way, you increase its potency. You can also look for mimetics in which you just add the compounds which are, we have for sugar units which bind to the same receptor. You can find that if you give this polymer, it's non-toxic. Okay, we selected it this way, but it modifies macrophage migration. This work, which was also then done, combination of Tuan Lamas, co-chairman, was involved in this work. And finally, since you have this, you can go and look more deeply into inflammatory liver diseases by having a compound which has a targeting unit, but the targeting unit, by binding, also modifies the activity of certain tumor cells, mostly macrophages. I say, in this context, a very recent thing on which we work is trying to repolarize macrophages from M2 to M1. And I think this might be very important later on for tumor therapy, because first, macrophages can exist in two forms, which are just like black and white, but they derive from the same basic cell, which is M0. This M1 is for macrophage, you know, it kills pathogens, it is tumor suppressive and increases the immune system. But this M2 system is immune suppressive, supports angiogenesis, and produces growth factor. This M2. So this M2 is close to the tumor associated macrophages, and it helps the tumor to survive and to form a immunosuppressive milieu. And then say, it's possible to make polymers which have mannose. Mannose receptor is especially expanded in this M2 macrophages. And so make this, we could selectively target with strong preference M2 macrophages and observe a knockdown of proteins. And the thing is now, this is in vitro, for transforming it, we have to look for really diseases and for clinically relevant topics where you can differentiate between. Maybe it's a great potential. And so when I'm done with my presentation, and I think this is the beginning of a series of presentations, where the next one will be Professor Kataoka, and then we will have four more presentations which address different aspects of synthesizing materials, nanocarriers, also in the context of the immune system. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Sentel. Open for questions? Yes.
Hello. Again, a question about positioning of RNA. Do you have any special reason why did you cross-link your particles before loading with RNA? And did you also try different cross-linking densities? So.
Yeah. As the thing is, let's say, if you want to transport DNA or messenger RNA, which is long, I think it's best to complex and maybe to cross to do some cross-linking afterwards to stabilize it. But for this siRNA, it's very short. And so the complexes do not get very stable, and especially they change from siRNA to siRNA, which you use. So I think this carrier somehow is made just for small RNA fragments, and to have a stable carrier system which is which the properties do not depend on exactly which siRNA you use. And of course, if you cross-link it more dense, the loading is a bit lower. If you cross-link it a bit less dense, you can get more siRNA in.
Try that?
Pardon?
Have you tried? Also, do you have results with different cross-linking densities, or it is going to be done?
I think for the cross-link density, we have no finally biological results. We tested it for the loading. This is chemistry, but I think this for the final biological experiments, we used one comp system.
We have time for one more short question. Come back.
Just a quick question. Is the siRNA that you load in the particles protected from nucleases? Have you tested it in vitro?
Pardon?
Is it protected from
yes.
RNases?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, we tested it, and I think this is the purpose. Okay, the question is, we cannot say something if we lose some percentage. But the big majority, which is in there, is stable and is not reached. And I think my simple picture as a chemist is you have something like a sponge and you fill it with something. And something may stay at the interface. But the majority is inside.
Okay. One more very short one, and then we move on.
What are the risks of immunotherapy if it is wrong?
Can you please repeat the question?
The beginning of the question is that immunotherapy around what?
What are the risks of immunotherapy when it is not perfectly studied?
Yeah, but I think, there's nothing without risk, and I think, and it seems to me that, for me, my impression is the immune system is a very powerful weapon of a body. And the immune system can clearly kill you. And what you do here is you have a system for which the tumor is a bit different from the other cells, but the immune system does not act against him. And to really activate it strongly, it may be that you increase the risks for some autoimmune diseases. But I think also, what comes around now with checkpoint inhibitors. Many people who take checkpoint inhibitors get some other side effects because when it's once you remove a break of the immune system and the immune and cells of the immune system walk around and they kill anything they think it's suspicious for them. And I think this is more a question to a medical doctor, but I think there are typical effects known. But I think usually, this is also a topic in cancer, you say if you do not try it, you will die. And maybe you survive well, but you get a side effect. Yeah, but I think also for the tumor therapy, the idea, of course, is with these carriers to make it more specific. This means, for example, not to activate the immune system everywhere, but to activate it close to a tumor. Or maybe if you remove immune tolerance, not to make it everywhere in the body, but to make it in places which are easily reached, and maybe to prevent the brain or to prevent the eyes from the removal of immune tolerance.
Okay, let's thank Professor Zentel again.